Alrighty. Welcome, welcome. Welcome to Evergreen Church, our church space. Find your space in the space. We're going to get started up here. It's always good to gather. It's always good to gather and worship. I'm going to welcome Lauren back up again. She's going to do our welcoming, and then I'm going to take over for... that's right. Whoop, whoop. I'm going to do... our worship leading. I'm not a musician, but I am a leader, so I can make that work. And then we've got the regular crew for the rest of it with Linda doing ATW and Danielle bringing a fiery word. Has been pretty fiery lately. So if you can check out the YouTube and look at the history archive services, if you have a seatbelt first, I recommend you buckle it. But let's go ahead and give it up for Lauren. Come on, Lauren, up here.
Everybody online in person. I feel like I'm still waking up, but that's okay. I'm here, you know? Okay, so the scripture that I have, the actual heading, it says a call to worship and obedience. And it's Psalms 95. So I'm going to read this. It says, "O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to him with psalms. For the Lord is the great God and the great King above all gods. In his hand are the deep places of the earth. The heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands form the dry land. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture. And the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in rebellion. As in the day of trial in the wilderness, when your fathers tested me, they tried me, though they saw my work. For 40 years I was grieved with that generation and said, it is a people who go astray in their hearts, and they do not know my ways. So I swore my wrath, they shall not enter my rest." Okay, well, I don't want to be in that last part there. And something that I was thinking about and actually saw a clip earlier this week was just talking about having parameters. And, you know, like, there's places I don't go. There's, you know, people I'm not with. There's things I don't say, things I don't do. And so even just, like, reading through this, it's like because of our obedience, we are able to enter into that place of worship with God. I mean, of course, not saying, like, I have to be perfect to worship God, you know. No. But obedience is worship. And as far as, like, entering in his presence, obedience, you know, is a way that, like, gets us there. So, and then let me go to this one. "For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice." So it's like we have parameters here, I guess it would be horizontally, but, and by having those vertically, there are no parameters with God. And so, I don't know, I've just been thinking about that this week, and that's just kind of what has been stirring in my spirit. And then just like being able to see like all that he can do. It's like, you know, the physical parameters, but there's no spiritual parameters, if that makes sense. So... anyway, I want to pray before we go into worship. So God, I just thank you so much for today, Lord. I thank you for opportunity to be in your presence and worship you. Pray that you would meet us here today, Lord, in a mighty and a powerful way, that you would speak to our hearts and help us to really receive your word, God, and to be transformed by your word, God, by your presence, by your spirit, or just by you in general. And so I just pray that you would come into this place, Lord. We are open and yielded to you. I just ask that you would have your way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Amen. Praise God. Yeah, if you'll grab us there. There, this, I feel ready to worship. That's a call to worship right there. A little devotional just to get your mind and your heart and everything set on the course there. This song we got, there's several versions out there. It's hard to pick the right one, to pick which one. That first one called Rattle, it's definitely, I check the range on the chord because I might need to be moving around I can go right about to carry is how far I can go. I know that before I rip it out of the thing. So I may go that far, got the parameters, right? So, but vertically, they ain't got no parameters. So I just invite you to jump on in. Lauren, if you'll hit it, hit the play. The lyrics are Auto Magic and Take Me Up to Volume 70. I feel like I'm a pilot or something to get set it to niner or something. Seven something in a niner. So we're just going to worship the Lord today. Praise God. This is a rather hype song, in fact, actually. We just pray that you would lead and guide us through the rest of our service today. In the mighty, mighty, mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. I want to invite Linda to come on up and do the ATW prayer time. Y'all can give it up for her, too. I know we gave it for Lauren, so let's not leave her out. All right. Here we go.
Makes me feel special. All right. Okay, we're going to do what we always do. We're going to say our prayer, right? We're going to say it with meaning. So, all right, let's recite it. Lord, I pray for justice in the world, for the lifting up of the poor out of their misery, for the breaking of the power of tyrannical regimes, for the end of violence, warfare, racial conflict, and strife. Thank you that you are a God of justice. Amen. All right, now we're going to go on. Our first stop is to Rwanda, and some of this is going to look a little bit familiar to you, but that's because Burundi had the same issues with the Hutu and the Hutu and the Tutsi. I combined them. They're Hutsis. They're not. They're Hutu and they're Tutsis. Anyway, as you see on number two, 85% Hutu and 14% Tutsi. And so there was this long, long, long history of civil war between the two of them. And we see on number seven that it culminated in a civil war in 1990, and the Hutu massacred 1 million Tutsi and the politically moderate Hutu in 100 days. It was the fastest and one of the most brutal genocides in history. And 1 million fled their country, and after the war ended, 2 million Hutu fled because they were in fear of reprisals. And this is still an issue today. They've had to actually, the president has said, no more Hutu, I'm Tutsi. No, we are Rwandans. And that's because they're trying to unify the country. And what was so amazing, I had read stories of the Tutsi that had actually, as being Christians, had to forgive those that had massacred their family members, brutally massacred them. And so this is something that we need to pray about, because they are still working through all of this. And we know that forgiveness is one of those things that we probably have to choose to do over and over and over. And especially when you have memories flooding back, right? And so we will be praying about that as well. And, oh, yes. And this was really, I meant to put this down. I didn't. I forgot to. So every once a month on a Saturday or a day, I can't remember if it's Saturday or not. I'm maybe interjecting that anyway, because I don't know if they're on the same kind of calendar days. But anyway, once a month, the government makes them all come together and work to clean the streets, to clean the schools, to clean any kind of public area. And that's the way of mingling the two ethnic groups together so that they can work together and learn to live peaceably together. I thought that was, I mean, I don't even know if this guy is a Christian, but that's a really good Christian principle, isn't it? Even though he's somewhat authoritarian, I guess we can see why some things have had to go the way they have gone. And then number nine, if you ever get the chance, watch the movie Hotel Rwanda. Have you watched it? Yeah, it's a good one. So it kind of gives you that historical reference, and it's a true story, actually. But let's look at number 12, 13, 14, and 15. There are significant health challenges. There's maternal mortality, and then HIV/AIDS with 33% of pregnant women affected by it. And we'll see over here in our prayer points why that is maybe true. And then poverty is 41%. Many children drop out of school due to poor quality of education, and then 41% of women report experiencing domestic violence over their lifetime. Okay, so let's go ahead and pray now. Father God, we pray for this president, as he governs this country. We pray that you would give him great wisdom on how to solve issues in the economic, education field, and the health strides will continue, and for his spiritual well-being. We pray, God, that you would minister mightily to him and that you would help him, Lord, to do things that are fair for all of the people, God, regardless of their ethnicity. We pray that churches will continue to preach and practice reconciliation and forgiveness among these ethnic groups. We pray that political stability will continue and that freedoms for expression, human rights, and foreign policy toward the DRC, that's the Democratic Republic of Congo, and we pray against any destabilizing activity in neighboring countries. We know, God, that this is a threat from several of their neighboring countries. So we pray, God, that you would protect Rwanda from having any kind of a recurrence, Lord, of the issues that has been part of their history. We pray, God, for the Catholic and the evangelical churches to be revived. We ask that work in unity will continue for the betterment of the people. We pray for ministries to thrive that help people practically. We pray that the small ethnic Twa people will be evangelized, Father. We pray for women at risk. Many, God, were widowed by the genocide. And we pray that those that had suffered rape during these wars, Lord, that systemic use of terror, they left them, Lord, with HIV positive status. They were psychologically traumatized and socially stigmatized, and many were forced into prostitution. We pray, God, that you would minister to these women, that, God, even to this day, are having to face consequences, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would minister to them, that you would give them the hope of Jesus Christ, and that there will be ministries just helping, flocking to help, to work with these women. Lord, we pray it now, and we're asking for that miracle, Lord, to take place in this country. In Christ's holy name, amen. Ole. Okay, so now we're going to head over to St. Kitts and Nevis. That's in the Caribbean. And I just wanted you to look at number 6 and 7. Poverty affects 1 in 5 people. And then the domestic violence is cause for concern as occurrences increase steadily. And there's been a noted surge following the onset of COVID-19. So this, that was the wording, cause for concern. So, and that, let me tell you, a lot of times I gather information, not only from spiritual agencies, but also from secular agencies. This was a secular agency that reported number 7. So that's not us trying to make a problem bigger than it is. This is a secular agency saying this is an issue. And so let's go to prayer now for this prime minister. We pray, God, as he governs this country, that he will do so wisely, that, God, you would touch him in his spiritual man, that he will be a Christ follower, and that he will do those things that are good for this country, Lord. We pray that in spite of plenty of churches and ministries, their impact is limited. So we pray that the impact of the churches and ministries will increase exponentially, God. We pray, Lord, that they will rise up in power of the Holy Spirit. We pray for the Holy Spirit to revive, empower, and embolden believers for the kingdom effectiveness. We pray especially for ministries that draw together the diverse denominations, such as the Evangelical Association and the Youth Impact Ministries. Lord, let your blessing of peace and unity be upon these ministries. Lord, let them work together for the kingdom good. We pray that God might work to restore the strength of family life. Women lead 45% of the households. God, we pray now that they will do such a wonderful, powerful job of leading their children. But God, we also pray that men will rise up and to the occasion of fathering those that they themselves in the natural father, but also, God, those that are around them that need father figures, that there will be powerful men of God to rise up and fill that position. And we pray for those suffering domestic violence now in the mighty name of Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, for you are able. In Christ's name, amen. Okay, so you might think I made a mistake because we go over to St. Lucia and number 12. It says the same thing, that 45% of households are led by women. their fatherless homes. So see, that's been a theme. Have you noticed that some weeks we just have a theme going on with some of these countries? And so Stewie pointed that out. But that was a theme this week, is that these particular Caribbean islands, which are beautiful, you know, people flock there to have rest and relaxation and fun, but yet right there, they're suffering a great harm, aren't they? So we will need to pray specifically for these things as we do so this coming week. So now then, number two, I said the religious climate is tolerant. I don't mean to say that they're tolerant of other religions. I'm saying that they're so tolerant that anything goes. That's what I meant. I didn't explain that well enough. So even though it's 95% Christian, it's kind of like, oh, you know, whatever you want to do, do. What makes you feel good? So that's something that we will need to pray about in this particular country. Number 11 and 12, domestic violence is a significant problem, yet again, with the surge of lockdown. And then number 12, 86% of all children are born out of wedlock. And then we say the 45% that have no father in the home. So let's go to prayer over this particular country. Oh, God, we pray right now for this prime minister as he governs. We pray, Lord, that he will have solutions for the problems that face his particular country. We pray, God, that he will be a Christ follower devoted to you, Lord. We pray, God, for genuine renewal in the churches and for the spiritual and moral transformation of this society. We pray that the veneer of religion without true faith that is a widespread problem will now be confronted by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that historic churches that are in decline will rise up, Lord, and have a renewal. We pray that Christian influence that has decreased because of materialism will now, God, have their eyes turned to Jesus, Lord. We pray for renewal, revival, Lord. We pray for boldness. We pray for a hunger in this particular country, God. And we pray, God, for those in poverty, those that are suffering from domestic violence, and we pray for the single moms, Lord, that you will touch them, God, with your powerful spirit. And we thank you now, for you are able. In Christ's name, amen. Okay, now then, we're going to visit over here the St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and there again is in the Caribbean islands. Did think number one was interesting, even though it's only 27%. The Pentecostals are the largest group of all faiths there. So isn't that wonderful? Thank God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Right. Oh, my. I like to hear that. Right. The Holy Spirit can just get through all kinds of barriers, can't he? So we thank him for that. Okay, but let's look down 6, 7, and 8. Poverty, 30%. So it's the poorest country in the eastern part of the Caribbean, and it suffers high unemployment. So that's the cycle. And especially among women and young people. Then number 7, domestic violence is a growing concern, increased during COVID lockdown. And number 8, sexual exploitation and child abuse is another problem that this particular country suffers from. Goes to show you can live in the most beautiful, pristine areas and problems are there, right? Because the devil's everywhere, but God is everywhere. Yeah. So that's why we're praying these Pentecostals will get on fire, yeah, and that they'll go out and they'll start evangelizing people and giving people hope. In the name of Jesus, we pray this prime minister will be inundated with the power of the Lord God Almighty. We pray, Lord, that he will minister to his country, Lord, as his not just a prime minister, but that he will minister, Lord, to this country. And that, oh God, you would touch him spiritually, Lord. We pray for revival and for restoration of a biblically based, spirit-led church. The country is religious, but most are not related to God through a personal faith in Jesus. There's a crisis of holiness, lack of spiritual fruit, and growing apathy, especially regarding missions. Oh, God, that sounds like the U.S. Oh, Father God, I pray, God, that you would touch this country now, Lord. Let your spirit just rest upon that country, revitalizing them, shaking up those dry bones, we pray, Lord. Rattle all of these countries, Lord, and let the dry bones, Lord, come together, and that the Spirit of the Most High God, the fire from heaven, will fall. We pray, God, for the smaller Grenadine Islands, that they suffer lack of churches due to their more isolated nature. We pray that the Methodists, the Pentecostals, and the Baptists will plant more churches here, Lord. We pray for those affected by poverty and unemployment and abuse. We pray, God, that the church will reach out and offer prayer practical solutions as well as spiritual guidance. Lord, we pray that now in the powerful name of Jesus. Okay, so now we're back home. We're going to go visit South Carolina. And number 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, it's pretty interesting. One of the highest infant mortality rates in the country and increasingly suffers from a shortage of physicians, and that's in the rural areas. And then, of course, we see number 7 says the metro areas have excellent facilities and health facilities and medical technology. But then look at this. They have a higher teen birth than any other state. So, you know, they need help, don't they? And number 7, I'm getting tongue-tied. Domestic violence ranks 7th in the nation. And then opioid deaths increased 59% in 2020 over the year prior. And it's the 5th highest murder rate among the states and violent crimes higher than average. So South Carolina needs our prayers, don't they? Even among all the good and wonderful things about South Carolina, they have problems just like the rest of us does. Okay, Father God, we pray right now for this Governor McMaster. We pray, Lord, that he will govern this state in the best of his ability, empowered by your spirit. Let wisdom come upon him. And we pray for his spiritual well-being, that God, he will know Jesus Christ. We pray for churches to experience revival and be bold to evangelize their communities, especially the teen moms, God, and the hungry and the abused and the drug dependent. We pray ministries will go out to those, Lord, that need help. We pray, God, that the hope of Jesus will shine to these individuals. We pray that more physicians will be called to the rural areas is to service those that are disadvantaged. And God, once again, we pray for the success of their industries as they minister financial health to their state as well as to the U.S. And we thank you, God, for your blessings upon these that we've prayed for. In Christ's name, amen.
Hey, good morning, everybody. And online, good morning. We're so glad you're with us. I'm going to raise this up a little bit. Or a lot. So I'm so grateful already for the worship we've had, and that rattle, you know, the song Rattle, obviously we can apply it to our lives, right? You know, we can do that. Another cool thing about it is, you know, that's obviously coming out of Ezekiel, and just to know that God has already returned his people to the land, and they came like an army back into the land from every direction after World War II. And then we know that's also going to be fulfilled again in the future, where this army of the Jewish remnant, it will be suddenly like they just stand up on their feet. And they're like, we know who our Messiah is. And that's when that will even be that fuller fulfillment of that. So even as we get to talk about our dry bones coming back to life, because they did through Jesus, we can also be so excited about the prophetic expectation for the Jewish salvation in Yeshua or Jesus. So I just want to say that. And I like that Lauren, actually, she read a psalm that talked a lot about things that Hebrews talks about, you know, like those that didn't believe, you know, corpses fell in the wilderness, all that. Well, the good news is that we don't have to do that. Like she said, we can praise God. But it's cool that she was quoting a psalm that we see so quoted in Hebrews, you know, all over Hebrews. But that's where we're going to be at today, mainly, is in Hebrews 7, a little bit in 7, some in 10, and a little bit in 12. We're kind of going to do a biblical jog through those. And the reason we're going to do it is because this is the title of the sermon: His Body, His Blood, His Blessing, and His Boldness. That's Jesus. Amen. I wanted to focus in on him again today. We focused on him last week, but I want to focus again on him today, because he's everything. All the life springs come from Jesus. Amen. God set it up that way. He set it up that way from the foundations of the earth. He didn't wait to make a plan. The plan was in place. The plan was in place to keep his people with him, Amen. With himself. Yes. And we're going to see how the Holy Spirit is such a specific person doing things as well in this process as we go through. But again, I want to focus on his body, his blood, his blessing, and his boldness in Jesus. Okay, and I just want to declare we have come to Mount Zion. You know, we're going to read about that later, but we have come to Mount Zion. We talked about this several months ago, maybe a year ago, but, you know, we're going to hear the echoes of the writer of Hebrews saying, you didn't have to come to the smoking mountain that was shaking. It was so fearful. People, you know, they staggered backwards at the power of God being shown on Mount Sinai. He's saying, this author is going to show us, you've come to Mount Zion. You've come to a place that's approachable. You've come through Jesus, through his body. Okay, so we're going to first start with his blessing. And I want to tell you what a blessing is. This is from One for Israel, What is a Blessing Exactly? Blog post. This is Philip Lytle. It says, he defines it like this. Essentially, blessing is God giving power to something or somebody to do that which they are designed or intended to do. Giving them power to do what they're designed or intended to do, or something to be able to do that. We also know a blessing is a favored position with God. You know, he blesses us, or with a person can bless us. And there's a closeness with the blesser. Okay. I want us to understand what Jesus's blessing is when we read, in, Hebrews 7. And we're going to be in Hebrews 7, 1 through 7. This is where we're going to talk about his blessing. But keep in mind that definition of what a blessing is. So leading into Hebrews 1, we've just talked about the hope being a trustworthy anchor. And the last verse before verse 1 in verse 6 is, Jesus has already gone in there for us, meaning he went into the inner sanctuary. He has become our eternal high priest in the order of Melchizedek. And now we start in verse 1 of chapter 7. This Melchizedek was king of the city of Salem and also a priest of God Most High. When Abraham was returning home after winning, excuse me, y'all, I'm having some things with my throat today. When Abraham was returning home after winning a great battle against the kings, Melchizedek met him and blessed him. Then Abraham took a tenth of all he had captured in battle and gave it to Melchizedek. The name Melchizedek means king of justice, and king of Salem means king of peace. King of justice, king of peace. There is no record of his father or mother or any of his ancestors, no beginning or end to his life. He remains a priest forever, resembling the Son of God. Consider then how great this Melchizedek was. Even Abraham, the great patriarch of Israel, recognized this by giving him a tenth of what he had taken in battle. Now, the law of Moses required that the priests who are descendants of Levi must collect a tithe from the rest of the people of Israel, who are also descendants of Abraham. But Melchizedek, who was not a descendant of Levi, collected a tenth from Abraham. And Melchizedek placed a blessing upon Abraham, the one who had already received the promises of God. And without question, the person who has the power to give a blessing is greater than the one who is blessed. Amen. This is where we talk about his blessing in Hebrews. And you may say, well, are you saying that Melchizedek was Jesus? Many people believe it was Jesus revealing himself in that body at that time. It's a very, very supported understanding of that. Others believe it was a representative, like a real person, but still a representative of the Son of Man. But I believe it was Jesus, you know, just from the fact that there's no ancestry, he just comes out of the blue and he shows up. And we know that usually when that would happen in the Old Testament, it would say an angel of the Lord had come and talked to them. That was the Lord. That's Jesus. Melchizedek didn't say he was an angel of the Lord, but he's a king and a priest. And Jesus is a prophet, king, and priest. We saw him as a prophet in the New Testament. We see him as a king and priest in Melchizedek. And so why does this matter? This matters because God doesn't violate his word. He has a priesthood out of the Levites, and Aaron being at that time the high priest. This does not replace that. it's important that we know that there's something called replacement theology. It's actually still in some Christian churches where they believe that the Gentile salvation, once we came, we replaced the Jews, or that the new covenant replaced the old covenant. The new covenant did something new in the sense that something is not able to accomplish, so something new and better comes. We're going to talk about that. But we did not replace the Jewish people. There are actually churches that believe that. And I don't know how you do that from Genesis to Revelation. I'm not sure how you do that. But I just want to say, so it's not a replacement. And neither is the priesthood of Jesus and Melchizedek. So God said that Aaron and his sons would be priests forever. The Levites, period. That means forever. That means when the third temple is built, there will still be a Levitical priest, right? So, and some people say, well, why, what's the point of the physical temple? Why do we even have to do, why do they, meaning those who will build it, why do they even have to do that? We have Jesus. We have all we need. Well, the physical temple is a shadow, a copy, a type of the heavenly temple and tabernacle. And God likes to put something visual for us so we understand what we have in the heavens and the heavenlies. And so this is very important. If you ever meet a Jewish person and you want to witness of Yeshua, Jesus Messiah, to them, you need to be able to say, we have no contradiction between Jesus being high priest, being the priest, and the word of the Lord. So he's not taking anybody's place. He's from a different priesthood. But he's from, so this, let's look at this passage. Melchizedek blesses Abraham. And even Hebrews 7 says he already had the promises and he even gets blessed more. So imagine that. His blessing, the son of God through Melchizedek, he's blessing Abraham. And he's saying, I'm going to go back to this quote. I am here to give you the power to do and be that which you're designed, intended to do and be. Amen. So it's like he's putting an extra blessing onto Abraham and all of us through Abraham. He's putting on Abraham this favored, if it wasn't enough for, you know, if it wasn't enough that God had walked and covenanted through when he walked through the pieces, you know, the half of the, I think it was a bird that they halved. But anyways, when he went through that, if that wasn't enough, that God said, I'll never break this covenant with you. Now we have Melchizedek coming and on top of that saying, now you're blessed to do what God has called you to do. You can receive the blessing of intimacy and favored position with God. You can receive this blessing in order that you can bless others. So that's what I want us to think about. Jesus, his blessing. His blessing is found in himself. Okay, so that's the blessing part. I want us to move over. We're going to now, in Hebrews 10, we're going to talk about the body, blood, and boldness of Jesus. That's wrapped in that passage. And let me just say this, even as you're turning there to Hebrews 10, 4 through 23, in Psalm 110, verse 4, it says, the Lord has taken an oath and will not break his vow. You are priests forever in the order of Melchizedek. So he's saying that to Jesus, to the messianic fulfillment of the throne of David. And the reason I say that is because it's powerful to even see this high priest Melchizedek is talked about, or this priest is talked about in Genesis, there in Psalms, and in Hebrews. And so it's very specific how he's put in there. It's a powerful thing. But let's read now. We're going to talk about Jesus's body, blood, and boldness. It says in verse 4 of chapter 10, for it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. That is why when Christ came into the world, he said to God, you did not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings, but you have given me a body to offer. That is so powerful. You were not pleased with burnt offerings or other offerings for sin. Then I said, look, I have come to do your will, O God. That's Jesus talking. As it is written about me in the scriptures. First, Christ said, you did not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings or burnt offerings or other offerings for sin, nor were you pleased with them. though they are required by the law of Moses. Then he said, look, I have come to do your will. He cancels the first covenant in order to put the second into effect. For God's will was for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ, once for all time. Under the old covenant, the priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again, which can never take away sins. But our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sins, good for all time. Then he sat down in the place of honor at God's right hand. There he waits until his enemies are humbled and made a footstool under his feet. For by that one offering, he forever made perfect those who were being made holy. So it's done and it's in process. And the Holy Spirit also testifies that this is so. This is really key for us to hone in on. This is the Holy Spirit. For he says, this is a new covenant I will make with my people on that day, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts and I will write them on their minds. Then he says, I will never again remember their sins and lawless deeds. And when sins have been forgiven, there is no need to offer any more sacrifices. And so, dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. By his death, Jesus opened a new and life-giving way through the curtain into the most holy place. And since we have a great high priest who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting him. For our guilty consciences have been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean. And our bodies have been washed with pure water. Let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep his promises, his promise. Amen. I want us to really understand the picture that's being painted here. This Hebrews writer wants us and those that he was writing to understand the depth of what Jesus's body, blood, and his boldness did, what they accomplished. Okay, I'm going to explain this for a second. I'm going to take you back to Exodus and just talk to you. When you had the first covenant given, Moses, he comes and he reads that book of covenant over the people, right? And they respond, we will do everything the Lord has commanded, we will obey. And then Moses took the blood from the basins and splattered it over the people, declaring, look, this blood confirms the covenant that the Lord has made with you in giving you these instructions. So Moses takes like a hyssop branch and he's sprinkling, right, the blood of the sacrifice that was just made after he came down from Sinai onto the people, because they said, yes, we agree. So he's like, okay, here, sprinkling you. That's the representation of them being cleansed, a representation. Okay. I want us to think how that's on the outside of us, right? If you get sprinkled with something like that, that's on the outside of your body. Okay. I also want you to think about the stone tablets. Those were written. It says that it was the work of God. That's how NLT says it. That when he wrote those commandments, it was the work of God. It was his own work. It was his own heart being put onto stone tablets. So they saw those stone tablets. That was also on the outside of them. The blood was spattered on the outside. The tablets were on the outside. Everything's on the outside. Okay, talk about parameters. Like everything was very... this is what you do, this is what you don't do. But then I'm going to also remind us of something. That's what the old covenant looks like, but the new covenant, Jesus in Luke 22, 19 through 20, it says he took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took another cup of wine and said, this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. So now, let's look at what this author in Hebrews is saying. I want to go up here. It says, that Jesus opened a new and life-giving way. So we have this great high priest who's gone in before us, but it says, our guilty consciences have been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean, our bodies washed with pure water. I want to just say, when Jesus gave the new covenant, he had them internalize what he was giving them. They took in the bread into their bodies. They took the wine into their bodies. And then on the day of Pentecost, because by the way, that festival of Pentecost, one of the pilgrimage festivals, that is for the law of Moses. That's Sinai. But for the New Testament, it was at the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came down and he physically went inside and he wrote on their hearts internally and wrote in their minds the law. That's powerful. So it goes from sprinkling on the outside. Here's the stone tablet, which is holy, all of it's holy, to here's the new covenant inside you. Here's the law in your minds and your hearts. It can't leave you now. It's internal. So everything goes from external to internal. So the Holy Spirit is the one who did that. I do want to highlight the Holy Spirit for a moment here. Because in Jeremiah, by the way, that's Jeremiah 31:31-34, where Hebrews is quoting, where he says, I will make this new covenant. I'll put my laws in your heart. I'll write them on your minds. I will never again remember your sins and lawless deeds. If the Lord is declaring he won't remember our sins and lawless deeds, we shouldn't either. We should throw them away. He's not remembering them. Don't you remember them. I don't need to remember them. He has thrown them away. He's not remembered them. When we focus our sight, when we put our sights on Jesus, we aren't remembering our lawless deeds, unless it's something new the Holy Spirit's convicting us of, and then we focus for the moment to ask forgiveness. But if we really focus on Jesus, we can't remember those things because we're so focused on him, our great high priest. It is not fair to Jesus when we focus on things that he's already forgiven us for. It's almost like telling him what he did was not enough. We know that's not true. What he did was enough, more than enough. And so I just want to say that we need to understand the gravity of his body, his blood, his blessing, and his boldness. His boldness is that he would step out and say, you've given me a body to do your will. I'm going to do it. I'm going to suffer. I'm going to pour blood out, my blood. And I'm going to fulfill what I even began from the beginning and that blessing that I gave Abraham. The blessing wasn't, let me just say this, the blessing wasn't spoken over Moses. Okay, Moses is not less than. Moses is like, I mean, incredible. How many amazing things can we say about Moses? There's a point of why I believe God had Melchizedek give the blessing to Abraham. It's because Abraham walked by faith. The new covenant is by faith. Messiah is by faith. None of this is by law. Law was what you had to do to get a completely wild, stiff-necked, crazy people to turn their heads. I mean, like, picture the sound of a squeaking door. You're like having to really turn them over. Be like, here's the law. Because you've been around crazy ancient Near Eastern cultures. And you've seen brutality. You've seen terrible things. You've seen a lack of a lot of things. But now you're going to turn your head to the law of God. He's going to protect you with what you eat, what you don't eat, when you wash your hands, how you take care of your homes. He's literally going to be a father to you. He's literally going to say, this is how you live life. These other ancient Near Eastern cultures, God love them because God did. He sent Jonah to Nineveh, but God did love them. But they were doing crazy things. They were eating things, handling things that like, that's going to make them sick and probably killed a lot of people. But the Jewish people were given, again, parameters of how to live. Now, it was a tutor. It was a teacher that led them to Christ. So the law is not a bad thing. The law is what's beautiful. It came from God. Our filthy rag version of righteousness is what's gross. But we don't have to keep it. That's what's great. We throw that off. We take on the robes of righteousness that have been, completely purchased for us by Jesus. But what I want to say, though, is that That's why Melchizedek was the blessing. He's saying, I'm going to bless the father of the faith that is going to come full circle and really close the loop of people, all people for all time who ever want to know Jesus. That's how they'll close the loop is in faith, you know? And so I want us to understand how amazing that is. And when he says their guilty consciences have been sprinkled with Christ's blood, he's picturing us, you know, like the priest that would go in. I'm not even talking about the most holy place right now, but just the holy place even. Just he's picturing us like we don't have to be sprinkled with anything externally anymore because now the guilt that we used to have is gone. Like it's pulled out by the blood of Jesus. And then when he says our bodies have been washed with pure water, they used to, in Exodus 30, you know, the priests would have to wash their hands and their feet in the basin before they went in. Even after everything else was right, they still had to wash. It was a way of approaching the holy. That's why it's saying, I've got to be clean. I've got to be able to approach the holy. Well, Hebrews is saying, yeah, you do that. Let your whole body be washed with the pure water of what? The word. This is not picturing baptism here. There's a lot of things that picture baptism. This one isn't. This is wanting you to understand the Levitical priest, how they did things. Guess what he's saying? You're a priest unto God. He's basically echoing Peter when Peter says you're a royal priesthood, a holy nation. He's saying you're a priest because of Jesus. So you don't have to wait for someone to make you holy. He made you holy. So go in. Can you hear him the way he's like, I'm gonna say it how he said it here, the word of God. Let me find it. Oh, yeah. So he says, this would be at the end of, this somewhere between 10:22. Let me see. I'll look at it with you. Because the way I copy and paste my verses, I don't see the verse number. Since we have a great high priest who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting him. So that picture of let us go right in, that's the boldness. That we can go right in because we've had all this done to us by Christ. You know, his body, he purchased it through his body, through that perfect body, through his perfect blood. So can you imagine, this had to be mind-boggling for, especially if you were like a Levitical priest, a Jewish person at that time. If you actually, like say, came to faith in Christ, you had to be completely mind-boggled because you knew that once a year, the high priest, only one person, went in. Once a year, Day of Atonement, went to the most holy place. And this is telling us, go right into his presence. Go right in and be next to Abba Father. Go get next to him. Go be with him. Like they're saying, wait, only one person could do that a year. And you better not mess up or the bells are going to tell us you died. But now you're telling me to go right in. No, don't stop. Run right into the throne room. And that's how powerful Jesus' blood is. His blood was so righteous and perfect and powerful that it completely made us all able to run right in. It's like, don't stop. Don't figure it out. You just got cleansed. Run right into the Father. You know, that pictured, you know, thank God for the law of Moses and this holy, visible thing that we had on earth to see what would happen in the Spirit. So don't let us not ever let anyone talk down about the ways of the Old Testament. That's our God. And that is his temple. And now his temple, we're his temple. That's incredible. And somebody may still say, wow, but what about the third temple? That's God's business. If he wants it that way, we're going to do it that way. You know what I mean? If that's what he wants, what's what we're going to do? Because it's going to picture one more time what the temple looks like so that then that heavenly temple can be pictured even more. Okay? And so that's what I want to say is, Jesus' blood is so powerful that he swept us all up into this priesthood that says, everybody, everybody come in. And once for all time, that over and over trying to push, and it did, it pushed the sin forward. It relieved your guilty conscience for a second. Now, internally, you're like, it's gone. I'm not guilty anymore. like Jesus washed my sins away. That's the power of the body, the blood, the blessing, and the boldness is that Jesus did it for us. Thank you, Lord. Yes. And, you know, can you imagine God's finger writing on the stone tablets on the mountain? Can you imagine it? Can you imagine just even, I mean, that's what I'm saying about Moses. Like, even though I'm saying Melchizedek and Abraham, blessing, I mean, Moses was such an incredible, incredibly blessed person to get to see what he saw. And, you know, he was up there 40 days and 40 nights, and he's seeing all this happen. And you know, it's hard when you read that he came down and there was idol worship. I mean, I know I've done things like that to the Lord, but I also, the Red Sea parted. I don't know, it makes me spiritually, like, it grieves me to think of him coming down, like him seeing what was happening down on the mountain, at the bottom of the mountain. It makes me want to grip my teeth spiritually, where I'm like, seriously, guys, like, how can you say that this golden thing that you made got you through the Red Sea? I'm just like, oh, you know. But then I have to remember how many times the Lord looked at me like, Danielle, we've been over this. Like, how can you do this, Danielle? You know, I know he's, you know, I don't know what language he's used. Like, how can you do this? I'm not saying that God said that way. But how many times have I done that? You know, but guess what? Jesus, his body, his blood, his blessing, his boldness comes right in. And I'm like, we're good because I have him. And he can actually tell me right before. But so I just want us to, again, imagine God's finger writing these on these tablets. But then when you suddenly realize the Holy Spirit doing it in your heart, imagine God's finger on your heart. He's putting his law in your heart and he's writing it on your mind. I just, it's hard for me. It's hard to really conceive of that, how powerful that is. The Holy Spirit actually writing on our minds. The Holy Spirit is powerful. You know, when people try to push the Holy Spirit back, I'm like, you know what? The Word of God just said that he was the one doing it, and it called him Lord. So you need to bow the knee to him too. He is fully in the Godhead, you know, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. There's not a separation of that. I just want to just honor the Holy Spirit in that today. And so I'm going to read just here three verses from Hebrews 12. And this is the excitement when I first said, you know, you've come to Mount Zion. Here it is. This is what tells us all this goodness that we've come to. It says in verse 22, no, you have come to Mount Zion. This is Hebrews 12. To the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to countless thousands of angels in a joyful gathering. You have come to the assembly of God's firstborn children, whose names are written in heaven. You have come to God himself, who is the judge over all things. You have come to the spirits, that's lowercase, so spirits of the righteous ones in heaven who have now been made perfect. You have come to Jesus, the one who mediates the new covenant between God and people, and to the sprinkled blood, which speaks of forgiveness, yes, instead of crying out for vengeance like the blood of Abel. Blood cries out for vengeance. Right now, anyone who's murdered, their blood is crying out to God. Thank God we have detectives that will find these things out on earth to help find, you know, justice for families, but that blood cries for justice. But the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus is speaking out forgiveness. So can just, how beautiful is that he's this innocent, perfect man, God man, who did everything for humanity. Even while he walked the earth, he just loved people and made them whole, and then he's murdered. He was murdered. Okay. And some people may say, by who? By destiny. He had to be. Okay. And he knew that. So God said, there's my son. It is not cosmic child abuse, progressive Christians. I'm sorry. You are mistaken. That is God. It pleased him. Did it please him to see that pain in his son? Absolutely not. That son is part and parcel of himself. That didn't please him. That part, the pain, what pleased him is the long game. The enemy will always ask us about the short game, but the Holy Spirit's always talking about the long game, you know? He's talking about the long game. And so Jesus is like, I've come to do your will. You provided a body for me. Let's do this. He did that like way back. Like I said, foundation of the earth. He's like, you're going to give me a body? I'm going to walk into it. I'm going to do your will. That's not an unwilling vessel. That is a completely willing vessel. And so he came, and even being innocent and killed, his blood, as it was being poured out for us, was saying forgiveness, forgiveness, forgiveness. Not vengeance, vengeance, vengeance. Not find out who did this and punish people. No, it was forgive these people, forgive these people, forgive these people. They don't know what they're doing. Forgive these people. And this is the only way it can happen. And he's saying, I'm so glad because now we're going to be together again. Really together again. I mean, like, I'm going to live in you. You're going to be my temple. And then you're going to be next to another person that's my temple. And then that person will be next to another person. And then we're going to be a building. And then you're going to be a bride. You're going to be this, all these beautiful things to me. And that's what is so awesome, that his blood cries forgiveness. And Abel, you know, was such a type of Christ. You know, he just came, he gave his offering, and we know how that went. But Jesus has even redeemed what happened to Abel. You know, he's redeemed that. He will redeem everything in our lives. And so you may say, well, how do we apply this word? This is a great theological word, but how do we apply it? Well, if we will meditate on his body, on his blood, on his blessing in the priesthood of Melchizedek, on his boldness, we will pray with more power. We will pray with more faith. We will say, look at what you did. It's beautiful. It's powerful. Your blood absolutely will heal me. Your blood absolutely already saved me. Your blood, as Hebrews says in another part, speaks a better word. It speaks a word of final fulfillment, of being able to be brought in. It will change how we pray. We'll pray with authority. We'll say, I'm a priest unto God. Through his body, through his blood, through his blessing, through his boldness, I come right into the throne room of grace and I say, Father, will you do this for your son, the sake of your son, and for the glory of your name? And he says, yes, I will. And he does it the way he wants to do it. But he does it because he hears our prayers. So we can pray with authority when you know who you are. When you know who you are. And so I want us to let this change how we even pray today. Let this change how we pray from now on. You know, I love that. I just want to honor any of our Catholic brothers and sisters who are really like following Jesus, because they focus on his body and blood so much. And that is a wonderful thing for them to do. And so I just feel that there's something that happens when we focus on him. Okay. And so today, let's do that. Let's have prayer and let's focus on all that he did. And let it be something that we meditate on. So let's pray together. Father, we come right into your presence because of your son, Jesus. We thank you that you have made us priests unto you, God, through the blood of your son, Jesus, through his body that was completely sacrificed for us. Lord, we just want to thank you too that you blessed through Melchizedek forward and said, look, this is salvation. You can do what I've called you to do. You can move in the purpose I've called you to move in. And that boldness is there, that we don't run in with our own gusto. We run in in the boldness of Jesus, saying, Jesus made a way for me. God, thank you that your son made a way for me. I'm standing in front of you. So Lord, let us never take it lightly, that we can present intercession before you, that we can pray before you, that we can bring praise before your throne. Let us not take it lightly because it was done through your son Jesus' body blood. Lord, you did it for us. And so, Lord, when we go in there, go into the Holy of Holies, into your very presence, let us pray now with faith. That's not wavering. It's said because you keep your promise. And so, Lord, we come in. We come to Mount Zion. We come to this great cloud of witnesses that's talked about in Hebrews 12. Lord, I want to thank you Hebrews 12 comes right after the Hall of Fame of faith. All of 11 tells us who these saints were. And then he says, you know, and now, hey, you're surrounded by these people. That means there is a great cloud of witnesses. That's what it says. And then at the end it says, oh yeah, and you've also come to Mount Zion. You've come to heavenly Jerusalem. Jesus, you said, there's, you know, the time's coming. You're not going to worship on this mountain or Jerusalem or anywhere else, but you're going to worship in spirit and truth. From your spirit, from the truth of who I am, you will worship. That's coming to Mount Zion. That's coming to the hope and the promises of Jesus. So, Lord, today we lay hold of your promises. We lay hold of all the things that you've spoken to us corporately in the Bible and personally. Personally, promises you've given. We lay hold of them. We reach out for them. And we say, God, let it happen by the blood of your son, Jesus, by his body, in your timing, Father, and for the glory of your name, in the name of your son, Jesus. For the glory of the Father, in the name of the Son. That's how we say it. And for the glory of the Father, in the name of the Son, Jesus. And that's from John 15. So, Lord, we just absolutely bring all of our burdens to you. Lord, whatever is burdening your people, I pray right now they would feel encouraged, that they would bring it into your throne room right now. Whatever that need is, right now, that they would begin to bring it in and say, I need your help with this, Jesus. Thank you that your blood will never lose its power. It is so potent that I can stand in front of the Ancient of Days in the Spirit. Lord, we thank you for that. We pray for healing in bodies. We pray for strength. We pray, God, for direction. We pray, God, for just righteousness to absolutely grip every part of our lives. Because you're the King of righteousness, the King of peace. And Lord, we just pray that your righteousness and your holiness would flood our lives. Every time that the enemy and the times of this world try to make a deluge of evil come in, Lord, we thank you. Your standard will raise up against it. And we pray your standard of righteousness would push back against that in our lives even. We pray, God, that we would be a clear rallying point for people, that they would see those people know Jesus. They love Jesus. They can pray for me. I pray, God, that we would sit and stand apart from everyone else because of your blood, because of our confession of faith in you, Jesus. And Lord, right now, those who are sick in body today, we pray for Marshall and Madison and their household, Lord, that you would just rid this house from all flu or colds, everything that's coming against them. We pray, Jesus, you would send your healing into their home right now in Jesus' name. And Lord, we want to pray, Lord, for Brittany, someone that we knew from Campus Church. Lord, she lost a cousin in a car accident. Lord, on Friday, God, please bring comfort to this family. Please touch the children that were left behind. Lord, let the custody situations be put in the right hands. God, we just pray comfort and peace over this family, Lord, in this midst of this tragedy, God. And so, Lord, we just want to now worship you. Jesus, thank you for what you have done. Thank you for what you've done on the cross for us. Thank you for what you did in the resurrection. And thank you that you are the Most High God. You are our high priest, the great shepherd of the sheep. Lord, we honor you, Jesus, for where you are right now, for what you are doing. We honor your name. We thank you for the Spirit of God that you sent to us. Spirit of God, thank you for writing your laws on our minds, for placing them in our spirits, to where you said you won't even have to tell a neighbor. You won't even have to tell a neighbor, live for God. They'll know. So Spirit of God, thank you that your witness is so strong, that people know so deeply what is right and wrong. Lord, we pray that people would respond to that call of salvation, when they would come to you, Lord. And so, Lord, we honor you. We thank you for the blessing that's over our lives to do your purposes. Thank you for that boldness to come straight into your throne room. We just honor you today and praise your holy name. We lift it up in faith, in humility, and in boldness of Jesus. In your name, Jesus, amen. Amen. And if anyone has any, you know, more prayer needs you want to pray, let me know. Obviously, we can all pray together. And online, please let us know as well. And Stewie had, did you want to do the offering? Or we're going to start trying to incorporate offering into our worship. People give already, but we just want to start incorporating that as well. And but even as we close out offering, we're going to put music on and have time to pray for anyone who wants to pray longer.
Yes, and so logistically, our little offering box is in the back there. A lot of you guys do an online give, and that'll be on our little looping slideshow. But I just want to pray over it. Lord, we do pray over our offering, and there's tons of Old Testament stuff about tithe and 10% and so much richness there to get. And then somehow into the New Covenant, there's like a translation that happens, and I'm looking forward to Danielle and maybe others bringing more teaching on that, just to help understand. The truth is, you let us keep 90. The truth is, we all need, I'm speaking from my own heart, the truth is, it's a reminder that I need to make maintenance my heart, like change the oil, you know, mow the grass. And it, for me, I feel like every time I give, I'm like reminding myself, yep, just got to get out there and sweat some, got to get out there and give, you know, got to do what you got to do. And it helps my heart stay in shape, if that makes sense. That's on a personal little note. But Lord, we ask that you would bless this offering and that you would multiply it and make it into something so great. We know that on this side of heaven, finances are helpful, right? They just open up opportunity and allow us to do things. And so lead and guide us even just how we apply those funds. Let them come in. We ask you to gather them all in. We just are so excited about the, you know, a cheerful giver, the things that we can do with the tools and resources that are there. Time and money is all we got in resources. So bless it heartily, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. And Daniel, sorry, I had this Run to the Father song. We're just going to kind of hang out for a bit. It's like a 5-minute song. We're going to cue that up. I'll be over here. I'll sit over here at the chat and look for you guys online. And just want to reiterate, you know, we're on the chat, but maybe this feels too squeezed down. We can set up a meetup with you and a call. And then same goes for you guys. You know, we're here, but also if we need more time, we'll make the time, you know, make time for what's important, right? So amen to that. I'm going to go cue it up and you guys can just feel free to hang out there. Pray for one another. We'll pray for you, pray for us, and I'll come back and close us out. Does anybody else have anything else, or are we? Okay. All right, well, I'll ask him here at the end again. Oh, thank you, Lord. So here I am back up. I told you I'd come back and close us out. Danielle had something. I'm going to invite her up in just a moment. And I want to share this, too. I don't know if this fits or hits anybody. But I was just like really sensing, like, you know, like the palms of your hands, like that is like almost like wanting to touch, you know, something, the Lord, you know, and feel a touch. You know, I know the scripture, there's references of, you know, touching the hem of his garment, reaching out. There's probably more, but I just, you know, Thomas, like needing to touch and feel the Lord himself, you know. And this is a man, you know, who was with the Lord while he was there. And when he came back, I need to touch him, you know? And does that resonate with anybody, or is there anything to follow up on that or related to that? Just wanted to ask. Touching the hem of the, wow. That's great. And if there's, you know, feel free to grab me after service too, but if you want to come, I want to invite Danielle, had something, and you can probably close this out or keep it rolling, however you want to do it.
Yeah, close this out. I was going to tell y'all, Pam Schubert that was here last week, she said to make sure and tell y'all that her knees are good. Like God healed her last week when we prayed. I know. Yes. Yes. So it happened, guys. It happened. So the blood of Jesus will never lose its power. It's still healing. And Stewie asked if anybody resonated what he said about grabbing or touching. And it's crazy because right before he came up here, I was picturing grabbing the hem of Jesus' garment for Carrie, like praying, like, Jesus, we need you to heal her jaw. And so that's what was in my mind sitting there. And so, yeah, reach out and touch him because we're in the Holy of Holies. All we have to do is say, Jesus, I just want to be in your presence. Father, I just want to be with you. And we're there. In faith, we're there. And so be encouraged in your prayer life. Be encouraged in your spiritual walk with Jesus, what he's done for you. And keep Richard, that was somebody in our prayer list, our family member. He's going through really hard cancer treatments. Lord, we just keep praying for him. We send healing to him in the power of Jesus. We send that healing to continued healing to Cheryl Cook in the name of Jesus, by the power of Jesus. So, yes. And I just, Lord, thank you for your people. I bless them in your name. Thank you that they're with us today. We're all together in you, and let everyone feel your presence and really meditate on your body, blood, blessing, and boldness this week. Amen. Amen. So thank you guys. Yeah. We're going to rattle it out is what Stewie said. Okay. You're dismissed, but you can also praise and do whatever. We love y'all.